Okay, let's begin. Thank you. My name is Robin Lewis, and I am a professor and director of the MGPP program in Moscow, in Vernetba. I will speak in English because я говорю очень плохо, очень ужасно по-русски, так по-русски. But I wanted to begin by showing you just an outline of what I'm going to talk about. I may not do it in exactly that order toward the end, but this is basically what I will talk about today. The title, as some of you may have seen, actually has another part to it. It's Global Public Policy, a Key to Russia's Future, and maybe to your future as well. I want to begin by addressing an issue that tends to come up these days. It's very much a feature of our world today, and it has to do with points of view and perspectives and ideologies and representation. Whose view am I giving you here? Well, obviously, first of all, I'm giving you my view. But secondly, I need to say that what I am going to talk about today and the perspective I offer you is neither an American one. It's certainly not an American one. It's also not a Russian one. Now, as it happens, I am half American and half Russian. My mother was Russian, my father was American, but I grew up largely in New York, which is not quite America. But what I'm giving you here is actually the point of view, above all, of a global public policy professional. I have worked all my life in this field as an educator, as a trainer, as an advisor to governments, to organizations, and above all, to students, about how to build careers and really, you know, this is where the words of the summer campus are perfect, how to build ideas, values, and knowledge to create opportunities. This is the territory of opportunities we're in. And that's kind of the first very quick answer to the question, what is public policy? Public policy is a term that doesn't translate very well into some languages. It's certainly difficult in Russian. Most Russians say, well, what is public policy? So I'm going to begin there. And I'm going to begin with the original word for public. Public comes from a word from Latin, from ancient Rome, and public has three meanings, not one. And it's the relationship between those three meanings that gives you a key to what public policy is. Public, or publius is the Latin word, means first, most obvious, of the people. Second, it also means of the state. And third, it means done by the state. So when you put those three things together, there's a basic idea there, which is that every state is the same as the people who live there, the citizens, the people who make up the state. So that's a kind of fundamental basis for understanding public policy. Policy is simply how you do things, how you solve problems. Public policy is all about choices, good choices and bad ones. It's a very practical field of study, and it asks a couple of basic questions. What works and what doesn't work? It also goes a little further than to ask why, and to ask what works here, not there. So it's based on the concrete, the practical, things you can touch and feel, not abstract theoretical ideas. A lot of us in our university training were given a lot of theory, and theory's nice. Theory gets you somewhere, but only part of the journey. At a certain point, theory stops, And then there's reality, which is much bigger, and which is about circumstances that human beings sometimes can't control or can't manage. And the final question public policy asks is, how do we avoid the mistakes of the past? So what I'm going to do today is to talk about how public policy is, and global public policy in particular, so I'm also going to talk about globalization, is really a very central key to the future, not just of Russia, not just of other countries, but really the whole planet. We have evolved in a certain way on the Earth that makes it not just desirable, but necessary to work together. I think you all know this, but there are, this is almost physics, that there are forces in the social organization of human life that pull people apart, that draw them separate from one another, and there are other forces that draw them together. It's those forces that bring people together that are getting more and more and more powerful, but at the same time, various things, psychology, the human psychology, the psychology of politics, which I'm going to talk about, pull people back apart. So it's this tension between togetherness and separateness that's the kind of contest you have today in the global atmosphere. I want to step back for a minute and say something about summer campus. Summer campus is actually a very good example, an illustration of what global public policy looks like in action. Because another feature of public policy and public policy thinking is that it is intersectoral. That is, it's not just government. Now, some people think when they hear public policy, they say to me, oh, you train people for government, to work in government. Well, possibly, yes, some people do go into government, but people go into lots of different things. And I'm going to come back in a minute to what those careers and opportunities are. But this summer campus is a cooperation between government, private companies, and non-governmental. On the government side, you have both the government of the Russian Federation and the government of the Republic of Tatarstan. On the private side, you have corporate sponsors, Coca-Cola, Unilever, who are international companies. You also have Russian companies like Gazprombank and Akik, who are companies based here in Russia. So you have the private sector and private money supporting your presence here. And then finally, you have the nonprofit sector, which is represented by RENAPA. RENAPA is a university. Now, it's a government university, but it is and funded partially by the government, but it's really part of the nonprofit sector. RENAPA exists to train experts, not to make money. So it represents the third sector. And the purpose of bringing you here is to develop the leadership of the future. It's both a great responsibility for you and also a great opportunity for you to think about leadership, to think about ideas, values, and knowledge, and how to put those into reality and how to put them into action. The choice that was made for you to be here, as opposed to many, many more students who were not accepted to come here, means that you're what we call in English the best and the brightest. So you have great promise. You were chosen because you indicated a certain kind of energy, ambition, creativity that means that you want to be here and you want to learn these things. And public policy is also about that. It's about solutions to problems that everyone faces, all countries, all individuals, but also that are increasingly difficult to solve. The world is not getting easier to manage, it's getting more difficult to manage. Despite technology, despite advances in science that offer great promise, the complexity of human society, the relationships between States, the relationships between people are becoming more and more difficult to manage in an effective way. And there are, obviously, and I'm going to talk about them shortly, there are problems now that may get bigger and bigger and actually threaten the existence, the continued existence of the human race on the earth. So it's a little frightening, and it's also a little frightening in terms of thinking that you're responsible for this. Now, everyone's responsible for this, but you have an opportunity to be leaders and to get people thinking seriously about these solutions. So that's what there is. I want to stop for a minute and say something that's a little bit philosophical. And that's to say that when you look at, there's two things about the history and evolution of the human race, of Homo sapiens. Now, Homo sapiens, Latin term again, means man, literally means man of wisdom, or person of wisdom. And this is something that you have to remember. Everybody today talks about power. They talk about political power. They talk about military power. But the greatest power in the world is something that every one of us has, and it's right here. It's the human brain. And when you look at the early history of this planet and the fact that humans were just one of a number of species, the reason humans came to dominate this global environment was because of their ability to use their brains and to evolve ideas, tools, organizational structures to manage their lives in a way that other species were unable to do. So that's your power. That's when people talk to you about power, always remember that this is the seat of it. This is where it really lies, not in missiles or weapons or political leaders. It lies right there. Secondly, and this is about globalization. Again, looking back to the earliest origins of the human race. Initially, people's view of the world was very small. The first humans only conceived of the world as what they could see in front of them. We know that people were hunters and gatherers, so they hunted animals and ate them. They picked fruits and berries that they could find. And everyone's view of the world was only what they could experience immediately. But then, as things began to evolve, for one thing, the human brain began to evolve and become more powerful. But humans began to develop other forms of social organization. They learned to group together into clans, into groups of various kinds. They developed technologies for agriculture. They developed tools which enabled them to live a little more comfortably. And their view of the world began to grow. So whereas it was first what you could see, then it became a little broader. And then as you get into the last few thousand years, the evolution of humans into organizations, into towns and then cities, settlements, social structures, people's view of the world got bigger and bigger and bigger. And then with the rise of technology, the Middle Age, at the beginning of the age of exploration, people being able to travel first on ships, later across land, various ways in which they could reach out, people's view became wider and wider. Today, you have in your hand, you all have these machines of various sizes, we all do, you have access to the whole world. So this is the evolution that is not, it's not necessarily good or bad, it's the reality that you live in. And that says to me that the need for people, organizations, and ultimately states to cooperate and collaborate is inevitable. That's the only key, the only possibility for a successful human future. So let me then go back to a bit to global public policy and what this is about, what the study of public policy is about. Public policy is concerned with enabling governments to think about working toward a common good. Now, one of the terms I have up here, the second one, is public goods. And it's a good moment to give you a definition of what public goods are. Because public policy attempts to create successful public goods. Public goods, the best definition I could find, two parts, says public goods are for the benefit and well-being of the people. So we get back to that original term, public. And here's the actual definition. A commodity or service provided without profit to all members of society, provided by either a government, an individual, or an organization. So public goods don't just come from public structures we think of, like governments, state, local, state, or national, but rather from sometimes individuals create public goods or organizations do. So this is a way of saying, again, it's a phrase you've all heard, at least I think you've all heard it, which is saying the global is local. And that's really true. And when you think about your lives and your values, I think it's very important to see that all of your realities, all of your identities, are related. So you begin, and I think a lot of yesterday was about you as an individual, your ideas, your values, your knowledge of how you grow. But then the next level is you're all part of a family. And after that, you all live somewhere. You're part of a community. And after that, you're part of a city or a province. And then you're part of a state. Most of you Russia, but a few of you from other places. And then finally, you're also global. And all of those identities go together. You can't take one out because the whole thing collapses. You can't take the top off. You can't take the global part out because what happens very far away from your community, your family, or yourself may affect your future in a very tangible, real way. At the same time, you are who you are, you are developing values and a sense of yourself and what's important to you and how you want the world to look. You have to keep that connection going. And as you move up that chain, you are working with, interacting with, living with, thinking with other people, more and more people. First it's just your family, then it's a wider circle. Finally, it's your city, your country, and then the world. All those things are connected. They're all part of your perspective, and they ought to be. Globalization has meant the globalization of many things. It's meant global trade. So trade is the movement of goods and services. We've seen in the 20th and now 21st century, although the process began a little bit earlier, the rise of the so-called multinational corporation, a company that does business not just locally, but around the world. Globalization is also the globalization of capital, of banks and financial institutions and financial flows. It's the globalization of people. It's immigration, the movement of people, enormous movement between countries and even inside countries. Now, does anybody know what the largest movement of people in human history is? And it's very recent. From the countryside to the city, and in particular in China. If you just take the number of people who have emigrated from the countryside to the cities of China, it's hundreds of millions of people, and it's the greatest single unit of human migration in history. So this is happening all around us. Globalization is also the globalization of knowledge, the transmission of ideas. Again, the internet is essential in all this. And it's also, finally, the globalization of environmental issues, where what began by being a very local phenomenon, a problem with the water, a problem with the air, now can affect everyone. So pollution in China starts in China, affects the Chinese, but it moves. It comes across borders. It comes all the way to the United States and affects weather and air quality sometimes on the West Coast. It also comes here. So these are issues now that tie everything together. One thing that's interesting to think about is what are called, I think a good way to think about this issue is in terms of what you might call global flows. Now, the word flow comes from a river. A river flows. And what you have in the global picture today are these flows of four kinds globally, across borders. I've mentioned them before: trade, finance, people, and the fourth one actually is data or knowledge. The McKinsey Company, which is actually one of the sponsors of our master's program, co-sponsors in Moscow, the McKinsey Company has done a very interesting study in 2012, which measured these four flows. And it also gave a price to them. And the price of global flows in 2012 is $26 trillion US. That is 36%, more than one third of global GDP. But by 2025, just 10 years from now, it will be $85 trillion. So it will more than triple in 10 years. So these global flows are growing very, very fast. The other thing that McKinsey did was to measure what it called the interconnectedness. It did a ranking, number one, number two, of 80 major countries, to see which countries had the most connectedness to other countries in the world. And it's a very interesting result. I'll go right to Russia. Russia is in the top 10. It's number 9. The other countries in the top 10 that are really connected to the rest of the world are Germany, Hong Kong, US, Singapore, UK, Netherlands, France, Canada, Russia, and Italy. Those are the top 10. So largely Western Europe, a few of the small international Asian centers like Hong Kong and Singapore, and Russia. For comparison, Japan is number 21, so much further down, and China is number 25. So what this tells us for a moment about Russia, and we'll come back to Russia, is that Russia has a very big stake, a very big investment in being connected to the rest of the world. So the importance of this program and the kind of global policy education we're doing is to make sure, and when I use the term we, I really mean me and my Russian colleagues. And they're not just Russians, they're British and American and Brazilian and Slovakian, they're from a bunch of countries. Our students are from everywhere. They're from the Middle East, they're from Africa, they're from Europe, they're from Asia. And it's a collective effort to bring together Russians and international students studying together and building a common vision of the future. And above all, creating solutions for the future. But it's very important, I think, and especially in the current environment, to remember that no country, this is not a special problem for Russia, although this is maybe a moment when some people in Russia need to be reminded that you can't cut yourself off from the world. Russian history, if you know Russian history, has always been this tension between looking outward and looking inward, building walls and breaking down walls. And there have been, and history always works in, the best analogy is like a scale. The pendulum swings one way slowly and then swings the other way. And that's very true of where we are today, I think, too. At the moment, things go one way or the other. But in the end, what you need is a kind of balance. Now, balance is a very important principle, not just in the physical world, but also in the world of public policy. And I'm going to, as we go on through this talk, I'm going to give you some examples. I've already mentioned Russia a lot, but I'm going to focus on three important countries, mainly because they're important, but also because of the ones I know and the ones I've worked in for a long time. They are obviously Russia, United States, and China. I just, until early this year, lived in China for 7 years and taught at a Chinese university. So these are good points of comparison for us all to think about. Russia and China are neighbors, right next to each other with a long border. Russia and China are looking very romantically at each other right now, thinking about all the business and friendship they can do. So it's a moment to think about those relationships. But when I talk about balance, one of the problems, one of the challenges that you face in public policy is, and this is written everywhere in the materials you've already seen about summer campus, is how do you relate the individual to the state? And how do you achieve a balance that's productive? I would say that Russia and America present an interesting contrast in this regard. Now, let me start with the US. Right now, in the US, we are suffering from a process that's been going on for a generation now, which is an effort to make Americans think of the state as an illegitimate economic actor. That is, there's a movement in some quarters that's resisted. Again, there's a balance to some extent within every society, but governments in recent years, with some exceptions in the United States, have tried to delegitimize, that is, to make the government, push the government out of economic activity. Best example I can give you was a crisis, and for two reasons the best example, is the financial crisis of 2008-2009. That was a global crisis that began as a local crisis in the United States. And what caused it in the United States was the rise of these, some of you know this, but some of you don't, what are called subprime mortgages. These were mortgages that people had on their houses. And the subprime mortgage crisis, which began in a few parts of the United States, Arizona, Florida, became a national crisis and then a global crisis. And that crisis was a failure of public policy. It was a failure of government to play its proper role in regulating economic activity. To put it very briefly, what happened was that private sector interests, mainly banks and mortgage companies, began to offer mortgages to people who had, in some cases, no savings, no job, no credit, simply saying, you'll have your own house. That's the dream of everyone in the world. You own your own home forever. So they said, you can have the American dream of your own house, and your first mortgage will be very low interest or interest-free, and the payment's almost nothing. But deep in the contract was something that after a year or 2 years kicked in, suddenly a very high payment. So a lot of people paid no attention to this, they moved into their homes and found that they couldn't make the payments and lost their home. So it was essentially, you know, the oldest story in the world, human greed became a public policy crisis. But it was because the balance shifted too much. People pushed the government, or certain forces in America pushed the government out of the public sector. If you look at the past of American growth, economic growth, it was all funded and enabled by the government. In the 19th century, the big progress that the U.S. made economically and began to become a world power was the development, late 19th century, of the railroads. Built these huge railroads across America. Those railroads were supported by huge US government subsidies. Then in the 20th century, you had the interstate highway system, which is still one of the best in the world, all the roads that go across America. This really transformed economic life and commerce and made possible all kinds of new business and trade. And this again was supported by a federal highway system with money. And finally, the US government actually played a very important role financially in the early years of developing the internet and subsidizing research into how to create these electronic public goods that we now have. And again, because we all know about the bad things that are sometimes done using the internet, I remind you that public goods can be stolen in any country. People can take them for their personal gain and try and distort them. And when they do so, they are stealing them from the public and making them, trying to make them personal. So again, that's a public policy issue. In Russia, a very different story. Russia really is a country that made began a transition in the 1990s when the Soviet Union ended, from an administration system to a governance system. And this is a very difficult transition, and as you know, the 1990s were a time of much unhappiness, of distortions, of growing inequality. It wasn't always done right, but Russia came through that after the crisis of 1998, and the years basically from 2000 to 2011 or 12, the Russian economy and Russian society made great progress. But it's still a difficulty in Russia to, as opposed to the United States, to get the state out of many sectors. The state in the US is probably too weak, and in Russia it's a little too strong, in my view. So one of the things that studying public policy is about is finding this balance, and in particular, giving civil servants, government servants, the decision-making skills and tools that they need. So public policy education is largely about what I would call these skills and tools. And again, this is where it's very different from the kind of study many of us have traditionally engaged in. Let me find the right place. Public policy, I want to talk about just for a minute about what you learn when you learn public policy, what I'm talking about, so that as you think about your future education, you'll all go into different things. I don't think you'll all come to this program, although you'd be all welcome to think about it. I want to define for you for a moment how we think government, and not just government, but private sector and nonprofit sector needs to think. First of all, public policy, and this is very new in Russia, and it's pretty new in the US too. Public policy is interdisciplinary. It's not just economics, it's not just government, it's not just management. It's those things plus psychology and sociology and communications and, as I said, management and economics. It's all those things. So every public policy program in the world has people from different disciplines, different departments teaching. The problem with the traditional university is that it speaks too many different languages. And I don't mean Russian, English, Chinese, French. I mean professional languages. Economists have a language of economics, and they can talk easily to other economists, but not to historians very easily. Similarly, sociologists have a language, a professional language, that sometimes people outside sociology can't understand. This is a real problem because there isn't a single global challenge or danger today that can be solved by just one discipline. By just, economists can't, look what happened in Russia in the 1990s when economists were allowed to take over. It's a disaster. Economists can't solve it themselves because their view of the world, though very deep, is very narrow. So public policy programs bring together different disciplines. Secondly, and most importantly, it's a training or a form of education that is skill-based. What you learn is policy analysis. You learn to evaluate programs and according to their effectiveness. You learn to manage complex organizations. And again, that can be a private company, but it could also be a government agency, or it could be a university, or a think tank, or a nonprofit organization. You learn how to communicate with the people you work together with, but you also learn how to communicate with very, very important concept in public policy is stakeholders. Stakeholders are people who all have their shareholders in these public goods. They all own a piece of it. You're all from some place, you're all from a country, and you're stakeholders in that country, in that city. You're even a stakeholder in your own family. So learning to communicate to stakeholders and to balance the needs of those stakeholders is another thing that public policy focuses on. And finally, it focuses on the policy process and the outcomes of the policy process. Again, how do we tackle problems? What works? What doesn't work? Why doesn't it work? What can work here? We have a policy is always about something specific. How do you improve transportation in Kazan? How do you improve the water supply in Novosibirsk? All of these are, a policy is always directed at a specific problem that has its specific aspects that are not necessarily like anywhere. So you can use models from other places, but you can't just move them. You can't take a model from here. And this is, again, this is a problem. I'm an academic, but boy, academics sometimes have a very tiny view of the world. They say, oh, well, we have a model. Well, that's nice. That's a starting point, but it's not an answer. A model gives you something to work from to get someplace else. But if you can, and again, look at Russia in the 90s. A lot of Western advisors came in with an academic model and said, here, we'll do it in Russia. Just transplant it. Make a little hole in the ground, plant the tree, it'll grow. Didn't happen. Because models have their limitations. The other thing about public policy education, and then I'm gonna get to what I promised to get to you, which is number four, major global challenges. The kind of training you're doing here at summer campus is very important, and it's very much in harmony with the way we train and teach people for public policy. It's really the future of education, not just of public policy education, but of all education. And I'll tell you why. First of all, it's interactive. It involves people talking to each other, listening to each other, considering each other's ideas and values. It's not the old format. I mean, we're gonna leave lots of time for discussion, but the old format is kind of this. A teacher comes, lectures, but as we've all experienced, I'm sure, in our educations, sometimes it was very much one way. Lecture, end of lecture, bell rings, professor leaves. It's hierarchical. There's an expert, and he knows everything. He has the models, and you are passive learners. That's not the future of education. The future of education is more democratic, and it's more participatory. It means that people learn by listening to each other, by sitting next to each other. As I mentioned to you earlier, I didn't actually mention it, but I alluded to it. Most of my career I spent in New York at Columbia University, where I was dean of the International Public Affairs Program, master's degree. We had several master's degrees in the area of both international and domestic public policy. And every opening day, when we had students, now there we had students from every year, it was a big school, we had over 1,000 students, so every September we had hundreds of students from over 100 countries. And I would say to them, now don't tell my colleagues, don't tell the other professors this, but you are going to learn at least as much from the person sitting next to you as from the person in the front of your class. So that's the first key to this future of education that I think we represent and you represent. Secondly, it's a form of education, and this is very much the texture, the feel, the real meaning of your training here at summer campus, is self-management skills. And self-management is essentially a problem-solving orientation in the real world, not in the world of theory. It's good to have some theory. Again, I'm not against theory, but theory is a tool to get somewhere else. It's not an end in itself. So problem solving is the goal that we work toward. And problem solving consists of interaction, communication with each other, and then learning to think, to analyze, to really figure out how problems can be solved and what role you can play in solving those problems. Third thing, obvious from what I've said, it's collaborative. It's based on teamwork. You're doing almost all teamwork here. And that's the way the real world looks. Doesn't matter if you're in government. It doesn't matter if you're in an international company like Coca-Cola or IBM or McKinsey or, you know, Gazprom. You're working in teams. You're not working as an individual for your own development. It's constructive dialogue that's the key to public policy. And it's evolving a team approach where everyone contributes something. Maybe on one problem you're a very minor team member, but on another problem you're the key to success and other people look to you. You in turn learn to look to them when they have some special expertise, some special ability. And finally, public policy education, as opposed to theoretical traditional education, is project-based. It's based on focusing on a specific area, a specific issue, a specific plan. And again, that has to be interdisciplinary and it has to be international. Now, what I think we need to think hard about, and this is, I followed some of your training yesterday and I know some of your trainers, and three of the moderators are students of ours in the program from different countries in the world. But one of the things we're clearly leading toward, you're getting very detailed personal training in how to develop your ideas, develop your values, to think about them, to examine yourself and your values, and that's very important because, let's be honest, most people in the world get up in the morning, do what they do, or don't do what they do, and don't look inward. They don't examine what they're doing. That's the kind of reflection that everyone needs, and particularly people who are going to play a leadership role in the future. You must test your own values against other people. You know, it's very ironic. Some of you have probably heard of the British poet Rudyard Kipling. Kipling is famous for being the poet of the British Empire, which was an imperialist venture to take, a very successful one for a while, for a few hundred years, to take over other countries and to suck profits out of them and return them to the homeland. So Kipling is always talked about as the imperial poet, but there was also another side to Kipling, and that was a more reflective side. And Kipling said something great that really resonates for me. It's really important, and I think you all would think of. He was talking about England, Britain, Great Britain, and he said, what do they know of England who only England know? In other words, you can't just create an accurate vision of the world by looking in a narrow way. That's a primitive way. I said the origins of the human race was you just saw what you saw and you drew conclusions from that. But I would say that you don't really have values that you can count on until you've tested them against someone whose values are completely different. Not so much against someone, but with someone who has different values. So you and this is true with travel too. You almost everyone, I mean, there's some here from Kazan, but you've come across Russia, you've come from different parts of the world. People travel today. That's another major difference in how people interact and are no longer closed off from each other. And in a sense, you travel in order to find out who you are. Because if you don't, and I'm sorry to say that only 18% of Americans, for instance, have a passport. So 82% of Americans never leave America. And I would say to them, how can you understand America unless you get out of America and see what the rest of the world looks like? And that's the same message, I think, to anyone, no matter what country they come from. So you are in the process of developing your values in a context of this huge world of values that are sometimes very different. And that's why it's really important to have a kind of education that's global or international and that puts you in contact with a very wide range of ideas. And then you'll find that what you take from them, you don't swallow the whole thing whole. You don't listen to a Chinese or an American or a Brazilian or a German who says, well, you know, this is the way the world looks, and you say, all right, I'm throwing everything away, I'm gonna buy this instead. You don't do that. You take what makes sense to you from many different places, and that's what makes you what you are. That's what makes you unique, because you have learned the best of different cultures, the best of different ideas, the best of different approaches, and the result is yours alone. It's your perspective. Your knowledge, your values. That's how you construct value, not by limiting yourself. And unfortunately, there are a lot of people in this country, there are a lot of people in the United States, there's certainly people in the Islamic world who want to develop a view of the world that's based on kind of shutting out a lot of other people and a lot of other ideas and pledging themselves to an ideology. It's another thing about public policy is you can't operate an effective public policy based on ideology. In fact, one of the key problems of public policy is this: it's politicians. This is again another version of models versus reality. Political leaders have created a kind of opposition between policy on the one hand and politics on the other. Most government leaders, let's call them policy makers, because in the end, government policy is made by people who are, in democracies like Russia, US, are elected to office, other places too. But no matter where they are, they come with a strong ideological framework, because their survival as leaders is based on what? It's based on popular support, political support. So the problem is that policies have to be made that don't defy the many groups that make up a society, because all of these groups, and this is especially the essential dilemma, the essential problem, the essential challenge of democracy, is democracy is based on both individuals and groups. And groups come together because they have a common interest. And in advanced democracies, that is often power, money, and influence. So democracies today are, think of Russia, think of US, think of UK, it doesn't matter which democracy, Brazil, India is a great example, very big, the world's biggest democracy in terms of people, it's everybody shouting at once, saying, me, or my view, and as a policymaker, you have to listen to all those people shouting and figure out how you're going to transform that passion, that emotion, into an effective policy. It's very, very difficult. And finally, when a political leader is handed a policy or a policy solution, the first thing that they think about is not, is this good? Will it work? Will it solve the problem? It's, how will it affect me? Am I protected or am I threatened by this policy? Is this a policy that will further my career? Can I use this policy to show that I'm a good leader? Or is it going to get in the way of that? It's really a very difficult problem. Is, again, the diversity of human interests versus some more unitary, unified public goods approach. It's a real dilemma. I think you can, no matter where you come from, you see that tension all the time. And remember, too, that most political leaders only get theoretical and narrow disciplinary training, not the kind of interdisciplinary problem-solving training we get. And then finally, in today's information age, all of us have this overload. It's too much. There's so much stuff coming at you. Every time you open this, your friends, your family, this, pictures of beautiful puppies and kittens, pictures of people killing each other, it's all too much. And one of the things we teach in public policy programs, and we have to, it's unfortunate, but it's true, is if you're a policy expert, you're involved in the design and the implementation, the action of creating a policy, you're going to have to, in the end, you make this perfect plan. You have a problem, water supply in Novosibirsk, as I mentioned, and you come up with the perfect technical solution that takes everybody into consideration, that solves the water supply problem. But then you have to get some leader to say, okay, and guess what? That person doesn't read more than one page at a time. So you have to put your, this is where communication skills that you're learning come into play. You have to learn to communicate the absolute essence, the core, the true meaning of your idea very quickly, very short, one page, because he or she is not going to read the second page. So one of the things we teach you is called a policy memo. And this is an exercise where you have, first you read everything, so you're an expert on the problem, and your head is full of all the subtle and difficult aspects of the problem. And then you have to begin boiling it down, the way when you're cooking, you boil something down. You have a piece of meat that starts very big, but it gets smaller and smaller. You boil things down to where you have things of a size that is digestible, that your leader can take in and make an intelligent decision. It's a very hard thing to do. We're all taught, I'll say this is probably a fair generalization. In universities today still, we're taught too much, let's say, and certainly 10, 15 years ago, all of us were taught this way, to take an issue, write an essay, and your professor said 5 pages. So you thought, well, here's the basic idea, and here's some other ideas. And you kind of kept going, you kept talking, you kept writing, till you filled the space. That's not an effective training for policy. Effective training is to be able to pick out the essential issues, put them in a logical order, and boil them down to something that people can understand. Now, to get to that essence, you have to do a lot of reading, you have to do a lot of thinking, and in the public policy context, you have to talk to, rural population has come up, I'll get to that later. You have to talk to all the stakeholders before you come up with a policy. Okay, let's think about what the future of the globe looks like. Public policy is a way of trying to reach an organic Now, organic's a big word today. Organic means a process that is natural, a process that starts from fundamental principles, and organic things evolve naturally without interference. So a policymaker tries to get an organic consensus agreement on a policy issue. What are the policy issues we face today? There are many, many, many ones, but I'm going to identify what I think are the main ones. Probably the most dangerous, I'll start with the most dangerous ones, and the ones that are pretty impossible to contradict, that these are the challenges of the future. One is climate change. The scientific, proof of the way in which human beings have altered the physical environment is overwhelming now. There are still, in some places, what you might call climate change deniers. And the level of denial, again, goes back to that primitive human view, which says, pollution? I don't know. The sky's blue. It's a beautiful day. I once had one of my father's friends say that to me. He's a businessman, and he thought that climate change was just a joke. You know, that he would go out every day and say, this looks nice to me. I don't see the problem. But there's a huge problem. And the Earth is warming at a phenomenal rate. As you know, the habitats are changing. Certain parts of the world, including the city that I come from, including the bottom half of Florida, including the east coast of China, if the present trends continue, will disappear. Places that support huge human populations simply won't be there anymore if we don't reverse climate change. And public policy thinking has begun to evolve, collaborations globally between countries, between localities, between companies, to try and reverse climate change. Just as urgent, and we'll see if it's maybe not even more urgent, are two things: food policy and water policy. I'll start with water. It's actually very simple. There are a certain number of people in the world today, and we have a pretty good idea from mapping demographic trends how many people there will be in 2050. And with that many more people and the Earth's current reserves of water, it's not enough. That's the first problem. It just doesn't, it's a simple mathematical problem. Divide X amount of water by X number of people. It doesn't work out. Furthermore, the water that there is often in the wrong place. It's not where people live. Now, a great example of this is China and Russia. China and Russia share a border. On the Russian side of the border are some of the world's largest sources of fresh water. The great rivers of Siberia, there are huge untapped aquifers under the earth. And across the border in China, there are huge amounts of people who live in a country that's running out of water, and it's running out of water very fast. It's running out because of the climate. It's running out because of unchecked and unsustainable practices in business and government, and also because China's population and its economy and the use of water has grown enormously. So here, this is a real issue for China-Russia relations. How can you figure out ways to shift water from Russia to China, in turn shift resources from China to Russia in return? It's a trade. It's barter. It's international barter. But very important to do. When you come to food, you have the same problem. There's not, by 2050, going to be enough food to go around. And again, some places have plenty of food and some already don't have enough. As you know, a very significant proportion of people in this world don't have enough to eat. They live in poverty. They are malnourished. Their children don't grow normally. And these are issues that are not going to get better. They're going to get worse unless we have a global food policy. Now, technology gives us a handle on this. So one of the things that's developing is a field that you could call smart agriculture. New technologies for improving both the quantity and the quality of the food we eat at the same time. Because along with the simple problem of having enough food so that you don't starve to death, or large numbers of people don't starve to death, you also have the problem of the food safety. Now, food safety is an issue in every country. It's probably worse in China, because there the crunch between population and resources is the worst. But, you know, I was part of a discussion a few months ago between a Chinese and a Russian businessman. And the Chinese businesswoman actually said, well, we would particularly like to discuss bringing some food processing, Russian food processing companies to China. And the Russian guy kind of was puzzled, and he said, well, yeah, we have some good technology in that, but that's not actually what Russia's famous for. Why would you want Russian food processing in China? And she said, because Chinese don't trust Chinese food processing anymore. And anything foreign is trusted more than anything Chinese. So that's a public policy challenge. It's a challenge for policymakers in China, but it's also something that has to do with global trade and global commerce, is moving commodities, food or water or software, information technology, from one place to another so that everyone can survive. So these are certainly the key global issues, but there are more. Another one, which has been relatively low key, but there have been these spikes of danger in the last 10, 15 years, is global epidemics, deadly diseases. Diseases that spread across borders. People get on airplanes, they breathe germs from other people. And recently, we saw the most recent example was the Ebola virus, which started in Africa, and which there were immediate steps taken, but before that, the way disease can spread today is, you know, one person gets on an airplane and infects other people, goes to another country, and someone thousands of miles away suddenly has that disease and can spread it to other people. This is a global public policy challenge, how to build structures, and we have them. We have to make them more effective. The World Health Organization is one, where countries collaborate and share information. Now, in the recent Ebola epidemic, or before, when there was the disease called SARS, a respiratory disease in China, really the world made great steps in creating public goods, common procedures and sharing of information to combat these diseases. And so far, none of these, I mean, we've all seen crazy movies where the zombies and people infecting each other, Brad Pitt, you know, all those things, Z, you know, Planet Z and all that stuff. But, you know, who knows if that moment will come, but these are real dangers. These are things that the world needs to get together on. Global trade disputes are another example. The whole, you know, global financial system is changing. Russia, in a very positive way, is part of that process through the BRICS, which is Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, and the new BRICS Bank. As you know, the BRICS summit was just at Ufan, not far from here. And the new development bank, which is going to be a lending bank that's an alternative to the IMF and the World Bank, is coming into existence. And another initiative, which is largely a Chinese one, called the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, which is going to be based in China. These are alternative models of financing economic development in the future that will be very different from those in the past. One of the real failures of public policy, another one in the United States, has been that politicians, and some politicians, but the majority in the US, blocked reform that was proposed by almost everyone else in the world of the IMF, of the decision-making and resource control of the IMF in particular, and to lesser also the World Bank. The World Bank president is always an American, it's a tradition, and they don't want to let go of that, but Countries like China and Russia are very underrepresented in those institutions. So is it any surprise that those countries and other countries have stepped out and created their own institutions, the Asian Infrastructure Bank and the new BRICS Development Bank? This is going to change the way international financial flows move, and in a very positive way, by making them, what were we talking about, more participatory, more democratic, more representative, where people who are stakeholders have a voice in the process that governs their lives. Another global challenge, and this is related, of course, to climate change, but I separate it out, is natural disasters. We saw this especially, I guess it was 5-6 years ago, in the terrible tsunami that hit parts of Thailand and other parts of Southeast Asia, where an earthquake many hundreds of miles out in the ocean created this tsunami or tidal wave that killed many people. And we have the earthquakes in Haiti, in Nepal, in China, that have killed tens of thousands of people. These are natural disasters, but climatologists tell us that the global warming process means that there are going to be more, not less, of these climatic disasters. I've just read a piece last week that talks about the Western United States, where, you know, to be honest, people feel pretty good about life. It's the beautiful California, Washington, Seattle, those are beautiful places, natural beauty. Those are prosperous states with good business base. Everybody in the West feels very good about life. But underneath the earth in California and running up the West Coast are these natural faults in the earth's crust, that mean that there's great danger there. And science is developing tools to read these things and deal with them, but the most recent one I saw, people focused on California, but it shows the fault that goes up to the states of Oregon and Washington and says, if the really big one comes, there's about 50 to 100 miles of that coast that will just disappear into the ocean. So there are increasing challenges that places have to face. And again, if you say, oh, you know, life is beautiful here in California, why should we worry? Well, Californians know. California has had earthquakes, the San Francisco area in particular. There are wildfires, which again are human, man-made disasters. They're not natural in that case. So managing the physical environment and preparing for natural disasters is another feature. All of these problems, therefore, and finally, urbanization. I'll give you my urbanization slide. We all look at graphs in our work in public policy, and you will never find a graph that's more dramatic than this one, because what you see is that in 100 years, from 1950 to 2050, the proportion of people living in the countryside versus living in the cities exactly reverses, from 30% rural and 70% rural and 30% urban to the opposite, 30% rural and 70% urban. So they cross perfectly, and look where they cross. It was just about 4 or 5 years ago. So this is a big challenge. Let me give you a few examples. People are moving to cities at an unprecedented rate, and when you concentrate people, you create resource problems, public policy problems. Right now, in Russia, there are 15 cities with more than 1 million people. In the United States, there are about 12 cities over 1 million people. In China, there are 71. Today. But in just 10 years, in 2025, China will have 221 cities over 1 million. And among those will be 8 megacities with 10 million or more. And the biggest ones, Beijing, where I used to live, Shanghai, will be in the vicinity of 30 million. Now, it's pretty simple when you put that many people in one place at one time. you create huge opportunities and huge problems at the same time. So urbanization is really another big challenge, a global issue that's going to have to be solved by policymakers, and that's where I hope you all come in. Finally, I'm going to try and wrap this up so we'll have a lot of time to talk. I'd like to say a little bit about sustainability, number six, sustainable development, and then make a few comments about innovation. I think you're getting, I put innovation last. I wasn't sure if I'd have time to get to it, but I do. Because I think you're gonna get a lot in the next, I've looked at your schedule in the next week that talks about innovation, but I'll give you kind of one perspective on innovation that doesn't come from, you're gonna be talking to a lot of business people who are entrepreneurs, which is great, you know, to think about how you translate innovation into resources, into real results. But I'm gonna give you another perspective as well. Sustainable development is another challenge for the future. Now, think back for a moment to the origins of the world you live in. I mean, look at the room we're in. We have electricity. We have solid materials that are supporting this room. We all have clothes, you have seats, you have microphones. So you have all these things that didn't exist in the 18th century and even the early 19th century. And what happened, of course, was started largely in Britain and Germany, was the Industrial Revolution. Humans evolved machines to create more efficient mass production of all these things that make our lives comfortable. And along with the development of the Industrial Revolution, which then shaped the world we live in, was an assumption that's no longer true. And that assumption was the assumption of infinite, permanent growth. That is, there were no limits. No one in the 19th century or the early 20th century thought about limited resources, water, power, air. But now we know that this is a challenge. So we still have a world that we live in that's based on a concept of development that's 200 years old and hasn't really changed a lot. And it's resource heavy. It's based on the extraction of resources like oil and gas. And of course, the dependency of the economy in this country on natural resources is a real problem for economic development. All of the leaders of Russia in the last 10 years have said that over and over again. And that too is based on the idea that there's no limit to those resources. You just keep pulling them out, you pay the bills. But it's not going to work that way much longer because there are limits. And this is where sustainability has become a principle that is important, not just in terms of resources, not just in terms of the environment, but it's very interesting. It's also becoming a principle in the running of many organizations and many businesses, that you have to think how you create a model that lasts, that doesn't kind of race toward, some people, I have some friends that are like this, you know, when they drive a car, they're here and you can see the next traffic light and you know that you can go at this pace, but they rush up to the light and then jam the brakes on. Well, that's how a lot of economic development works. People race as fast as they can, use resources as much as they can, and then suddenly come to a halt. Sustainability is about creating a pace of development that can be sustained for a longer time. So this has to do with, in businesses and in organizations, with increasing efficiency, with reducing consumption, and with creating a future. The population, I mentioned population, the population of the Earth approximately now is 7 billion. By 2050, if you take the average of projections, it's going to be 9 billion. So that's 2 billion extra people. And all of the resources that those 2 billion people need. Could be more than 2 billion, by the way. Estimates, high estimates is 10 billion. And the fact that those resources aren't there. So this is a real, the sustainability is a real challenge because it reflects knowledge and values that we've discovered only very recently. And the development of the economic development of the world in the last 100 years has been so rapid, or 200 years, that people really didn't think about this. But now you can't make progress without keeping those principles in mind. So what it's going to take to create sustainable solutions to sustain human life on the planet is innovation, new ways of looking at things. And you're going to hear a lot of talk, as I said, over the next week about how you encourage innovation, how you nurture it like a little baby or a plant that has to grow. Innovation is something that starts small and becomes big. The power of science is something that can't be denied. Really, Europe grew powerful because it nurtured scientific inquiry and developed new technologies to cope with the world. China, in the 14th century, was actually the most advanced scientific civilization in the world. And China, in that time, was the richest country in the world. And then, internally, culturally, something happened where the Chinese emperors and leaders turned their back on science, and China declined. And China really hasn't recovered from that until the last 20, 25 years, where, in fact, the most remarkable story in the history of economic development has been the turnaround of China, the movement from a country that was very poor to a country that's increasingly, it's got a ways to go, there's still plenty of poor people in China, but it's becoming one of the richest countries in the world. So the power of science in that, in the process of economic development, is something that can't be denied. Also, as I mentioned before, railroads, technology, internet, highways, the role of the state. The state has to be involved as a kind of a nurse to nurture, to grow innovation, and to encourage competition and to encourage entrepreneurship. So public money is something that has to be spent, it has to be spent carefully, it has to be spent wisely, it has to be spent honestly, but public money can make a great difference in inspiring innovation. But when you read the literature of innovation, you read about the great scientists, people like Thomas Edison. Everybody thought they were crazy. Thomas Edison really is the one who figured out electricity. Not the only one, but one of the leaders. The light bulb, the phonograph, actually the first movie camera. Thomas Edison had over 1,000 patents for inventions. But people thought he was crazy. And said, when they first saw the prototype for an electric bulb, they said, that's not gonna work, are you crazy? So innovators are risk takers. You innovate by trial and error. You try things and you fail. Now, we're all taught to succeed, but sometimes you get in places by failing first and then succeeding later. So that's one of the real issues and one of the real principles of innovation. You're not afraid to fail. On Thomas Edison's lab, he had some sentences. One of them was, there are no rules here. We're trying to do something. And another one that said, 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration, sweat. You know, it's hard work to invent something. And that's what innovation is you should keep in mind, is about. Not only electricity, but the automobile, computers, canals, which were among the first things to increase commerce, were all seen as crazy initially. And there were also many failures. There were many experiments that looked very promising and didn't work. So this is something that also needs to be part of your perspective. And again, I'm not gonna dwell on this because you're gonna have lots of opportunities to think about that in the future. So I'm going to stop there. We have about 25 minutes or so for discussion and questions, but I'd like to end by saying that I envy you all. I wish I was young again. I wish I could start over again and learn new things. One of the nice things about my job has been that I am learning new things. I learn new things every day, and people put new problems in front of me. But I wish I had more time. I wish I had more time to learn things. But you have a great opportunity to be leaders in the future, to take all of these tools and skills that I'm talking about, to figure out the world around you, and to figure out your future and the future, again, it's a matter of steps, your future, your family, your community, your city, your country, and the world's future together. Because those things, those pieces all have to fit together or nothing will work. So it's a great opportunity, and you have to have patience. When you're young, patience is something that doesn't come naturally. The way at your age your brain works, it needs stimulation, it needs fast things. And that's good, because you can learn very fast. If you try to learn a language, for instance, and these are all, public policy is another language. Scientists tell us that when you're 22, 25 years old, you can learn a language much faster than when you're 50 or 60. So you have a great opportunity to accept these challenges and to really reach out and create some new solutions to problems that are going to be essential to your future and the future of your children and your grandchildren. So I thank you, and I'm moved. Microphone duty so that we can hear you. We can have discussions, questions, but I need someone to maybe run back and forth. Could you do it? Do you mind? Is it on? I think I just.
Is it working yet?
It's not. There's a little tiny red button on the bottom. And then, that's the light. Yeah.
Working?
Yeah.
Thank you for your lecture. It was quite interesting.
Can I ask you, this is just for my benefit, tell me your name and where you're from.
My name is Renata. I'm from Kazan Federal University. It was quite interesting, and I hope it will help us to do our project. But I have one question. What will be the model of our future world? It be like multipolar, unipolar, bipolar, and what is the place of Russia and role of Russia in this world? Thank you.
That's a good question. I both hope and think that the world will be multipolar. A unipolar world makes no sense. And again, I'm speaking as a public policy expert. You can't have one country or one perspective that fits all and that dominates all. I think a number of the problems we face today in the world are the result of in the Cold War, certainly it was a bipolar world. It was the Soviet Union and the US. I think that created a set of problems. I think, there would be people who say that now we have a unipolar world, that the US is the only power. I don't think that's true, but I think the US dominates the world scene too much. I think American leaders have a inaccurate vision of the world in terms of how they see the importance of the United States. Now, the U.S. is not an unimportant country, but it's not the only important country. Russia can play a very, very positive and constructive role. It has been already in terms, I would say, in particular of the BRICS. Now, BRICS is all about creating a multipolar world. It also played a role in G20, in APEC, in G8 before it became G7 because of the disagreements over Ukraine, but I think Russia, the challenge for Russia is to stay engaged, is to stay part of the world and not to say, we're going to do this ourselves. There are a lot of other countries that have said that. Look at China. China was isolated from the world for a long time, and what broke the back of a downward cycle that was hundreds of years old in China was in the 1980s, a few leaders began to open the door to the rest of the world. You know, when I talk to my friends about what it was like living in China in the 1980s, I was just having dinner with a friend the other night here in Moscow who was an American who worked in the very early days of the opening of China. It was in the early 1980s. And when you were a foreigner in China, and to some extent, you know, I first came to Moscow in 1988. So it was the Soviet Union, still Soviet power and so forth, and a Soviet system in society. In both places, as a foreigner, you were isolated. You weren't allowed to talk to Russian or Chinese people openly. I remember my first time in Moscow. I was interviewing students for some academic programs, and I said, "Oh, come and meet me in my hotel." And they said, "Well, actually, we're not allowed in your hotel." I said, "What do you mean?" They said, "Well, you know, Soviet citizens aren't allowed into these foreigners' hotels." And China was the same. You didn't have real money. You had what were called foreign exchange certificates. So this kind of isolation, China broke it, and Russia did too, of course, in a different way and at a different time. This kind of isolation leads to downward development. Opening up to the world, collaborating with people, learning from others, taking the best of what they can do, and adapting it to your special circumstances, because every country is different, is really the key to the future. It's sharing, not shoving things away. And I think, you know, that's every country has its tension. The United States has a long, long and unhappy tradition. In the US context, it's called isolationism. So in World War I, and even in World War II, when Hitler was raging across Europe, there were those in America who said, "Somebody else's battle, stay out of it, it's not our business. America should can stay strong by staying separate." Well, fortunately, that point of view didn't win. And you can imagine what the effect might have been. The war was really won both by the combined efforts, of course, of Russia and of the United States and of the Allies, and you needed them all. So isolationism is a problem in the United States. It's also, it's not the word you use in Russia, but kind of turning inward. And when you look at Russian history and culture, you look at the 19th century, there was this great battle between, as I learned in when I studied Russia, the Slavophiles and the Westernizers, that, you know, should Russia look inward to its organic soul or should it look outward? Well, the answer is, in every culture, you need a balance. You need both. You need to find what's meaningful and real in your own culture and locality, in your customs, your values, and your ways of doing things. But if some of those don't work anymore, you have to be willing to discard them and try other things. And that's a lesson for every culture, not just Russia. Next question.
Thank you for your lecture. It was quite informative. Thank you for your insight to global policy. I've heard you mention...
Tell me who you are.
Oh, I'm sorry, my name is Aygul.
From?
And I'm from Kazan Federal University.
Okay.
I've heard you mentioning that it's really the state's responsibility to nurture innovation and sustainability to really provide the better future for the future generations. And I was wondering whether it's going to work always. I mean, if these principles are imposed to society, is there any guarantee that they are going to be adopted?
That's a very good comment. That's very true. I didn't mean to suggest, but I might have, that the state has to play the key role in that. I don't think so. I think that innovation and creativity, again, comes from here. It comes from you and you and you, from individuals who have a vision of something new and different, like these innovators I was talking about, like Edison and Tesla and people like that. But the role of the state, and it's difficult, this is very difficult for any state to achieve, again, is a balance between, on the one hand, encouraging and nurturing innovation and preventing it. Now, in many countries, including this one, there are rules and regulations that make it very difficult for entrepreneurs, for innovators, for inventors to survive. So the first kind of, you know, the kind of first rule of public policy in some ways for a state is the phrase, do no harm. Don't prevent people from progressing. The next step is actually enable people to do it. But the first rule is don't have structures and regulations that make it impossible for people to innovate. Now, you know, it's again, the pendulum swing sometimes very, you can, almost can't see it. 2 days ago, President Putin did something very good, yesterday maybe, which is he signed into law a suspension of inspections of small businesses. Now, if you talk to small business people in Russia, and some of you may have family, friends, parents who are small business people, you know that there are these very sometimes oppressive business inspections where inspectors come and look at your records and look at your business and make it very hard for you to keep making money. He suspended those for 3 years, or two or three years, in order to enable small businesses to flourish in a freer environment. That's very positive. That's not the only thing going on. There are sometimes some negative things too, but that's the kind of, government has to know when to say, well, we're going to step back here. We're going to give people more room to do what they do well and not prevent them. But the best public policies go, as I said, the step further to say, let's figure out how to encourage entrepreneurship. And the way you do it, again, is the government just doesn't, you know this, I mean, I'm sure a lot of your brothers and sisters, or maybe you remember, little brothers and sisters, you remember this from your own childhood. If somebody gives you something for free, you don't value it. You may come to be dependent on it. You may expect that you're going to keep getting it, but it's really, if the government just gives people money and says, oh, go innovate, it's not going to work. You have to create an incentive system, and you have to make those people stakeholders, shareholders in their own success, rather than just giving them some resource and saying, here, use these resources till they run out. You know, there was a famous story of an American farmer, and the TV station said to him, well, if you won the lottery and you won $1 million, what would you do with it? And he thought for a minute, he said, well, I guess I'd keep farming until the $1 million ran out. So that's, you know, that's sustainability. The lesson is sustainability, is you have to create opportunities for people to build structures that will last, you know, that don't fall down. And whether they're businesses or technologies, you have to do that. On this side.
Their work, which is sponsored by budget money, they live on around this line of poverty.
Mm-hmm.
How to find this balance, because it's really concerning me, this poverty and this bad situation in this year.
Mm-hmm. Good question. It's very difficult to find that balance. And that's really, in a sense, you know, if you come and study for 2 years and work very hard, you'll have the beginnings of an answer to that question. So it's not anything I'm going to be able to give you in 2 minutes. However, you started with mentioning the summer campus and the money that was spent to bring you here to make sure you're comfortable. That's a good example of what I was talking about. And it's not just the state. It's not just private corporations. This is a collaboration, and the university as well, collaborating in creating, and the object of this place is to give you a place where you don't have to worry about, you know, where you're sleeping, what you're eating, and instead can concentrate on these things, which are important. So it's a good example of government, but in partnership with other sectors and other stakeholders, making, this is really an investment in you and in Russia's future. And I'm very glad, I wish there were more international students here, but there's still a nice number. And thinking through these problems together is very important for all of you. And you help each other. But you know, I don't think you should feel guilty about being here, but you should also not be, and I see no sign of it, so don't worry, you shouldn't be lazy about it. It's not, you know, it's not so much a holiday as an opportunity to develop yourselves and develop a sense of your future and of your capabilities and your talents. A lot of success, I mean, I've had literally thousands of students from over 100 countries in my time as dean at Columbia. And I always said to them, you know, your future success is going to be based largely on you asking yourself two questions. What am I good at? What are my talents? And what really excites me? What do I really want to do? What do I really enjoy doing? And putting that together, and it's not, you know, you don't want to answer those questions in 5 minutes or 5 days or 5 months. It's a process of figuring that out. And you look outward to your environment, to other people, and you look inward to your sense of what your own value is and what your own talent is. What am I good at? You'll notice that you're good at some things and not good at other things. In university, you figure out, well, I'm good at mathematics, but I'm not very good at writing essays. And then other people figure out, well, I'm good at history, but I'm not very good at mathematics. You have to be honest about your talents and your ability. But that's a very exciting process if you do it effectively. So that's really what this is about. And again, innovation is about that. And, you know, I think, I mean, it's my own father that gave me the perfect goal in life. And he said to me one day, he said, you should wake up every morning and your first thought is, oh, great, I get to go to work today. That's what you should work towards, where you're excited and pleased by your role in life. And it's not easy. Most people in the world don't get there. But you all have a chance to do that, and to do it partially because you will be doing more than just putting the food on the table and keeping a house around your family, but also because you're going to make other people's lives better, and through that, your own. I mean, charity begins at home, as we say, so you also work for yourself and for others at the same time, and that's very important.
Today we talked about the role of the state, and personally I study international relations, that's why my question is, my question is about the role of the state, whether it remains to be like a basic actor in international relations, or we'll see the rise of the transnational companies and international organization more than we have today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that, you know, again, you're an international relations student. How many other people here are doing international relations? So some. I mean, you know, one of the ongoing debates in international relations today is about the past, present, and future of the nation state. Now, I think, again, see, my training is largely as a historian, so I look at this historically and I look back and see what the lessons are. In the 19th century, which was really when the modern nation state was born and nation state theory evolved, that we still live under. So in some ways, again, just like the technological model, the industrial revolution model of economic development that still governs our economic lives is no longer what we need. I think also the nation state of the 19th century is no longer what we need. Most of those nation states were built on one of three things or three things together. I would call them blood, soil, and faith. They were based on, first of all, on belonging to a certain race. So the rise of, the great example, of course, is Hitler in Germany saying that, you know, the Aryan German race was going to be the future of the world. They were states based on territory, on soil, on, you know, this is our home and everybody else stay out. And then there were those based on faith, based on religion or some other kind of, or in combination, of course, of both religious faith and a belief in the Rodina, the people, the country, the homeland. None of those models turned out very happily. We still have states that exist that came out of that system. But the nation state of the future has to be something that's based on something else, that's based on some values and some principles that are, that offer, a sense of belonging, of being a stakeholder to all the members of that nation state. Now, that's not easy. Your study is all about how hard that is. That's what international relations is about. But I would say that the rise of international organizations, some of them, IMF is a good example, started out pretty good, but in some ways have turned not as productive. So other structures that I mentioned have come to, are going to replace them eventually, like BRICS Development Bank and so forth. And other structures that are working pretty well and productively. And again, they're working well because they're not based on blood, soil, or faith. They're not based on ideology. They're based on practical problem solving. Best example, again, World Health Organization that I can think of. Or some of the UN agencies. Now, UN agencies work better or worse in certain places, but UN Development Program, UNICEF, which protects children worldwide, those have been pretty effective in fighting poverty and fighting disease, and are great examples in some cases. Not all their projects are perfect, of course, but those are all good examples of new global structures that have created solutions to problems. And that's what states have to be. States have to solve problems in the everyday world and not appeal. Sometimes you have to appeal to popular support. Democracy is a terrible dilemma. I mean, I grew up in a democracy. You're growing up in a democracy now. You know, I tend to agree with Winston Churchill, who said, democracy is not a very good form of government, but it's probably the best that we can find. And it's deeply flawed, and it creates a lot of noise and a lot of confusion because of its openness. Life is much simpler if you have a leader who says, think this, do that, sleep there, do this job, and don't talk to me. I mean, that's a much simpler form of human organization, but we know it doesn't work because human beings have other desires and other strengths that are not nurtured under a system like that. So democracy is the most challenging form of government, but it is probably the best one. And I think all states, I'm not a believer that all states have to take a democratic form, China is a good example. I have a lot of criticisms of China today and the way China operates and the way China treats some of its citizens, but China has done a remarkable job of pulling literally hundreds of millions of people out of poverty in a very short time using a system that is not democratic. So you can't just say that, again, this is the weakness of the model. You can't say this is the model and you take the democratic model. American policymakers are terrible at this. They think only if everyone, see, this is the great illusion of political leadership today. If everyone was like me, a political leader says, we'd have no problems. If everyone was like us and did things like we do them, then it would be a great world. Well, it doesn't work that way. People have to evolve their own ways of doing things. And you have to, you know, among the values that, that the group I was talking about, one of them is tolerance. You have to see that other people have other ways of looking at the world and you have to learn to respect those. And at the same time to evolve your own vision of what your world and your country looks like. So it's a real challenge. It's not easy, but it's the only, you know, it's the only way to go. It's the only way you can do it, way you can develop.
Thank you for your lecture. My name is Sevold. I'm from St. Petersburg, Northwestern Institute of Management, International Relations too. Well, and I have a question. What is the future of globalization in your opinion? Will it maybe absorb cultures of the other countries? And is it good or bad process?
The European integration process?
Yes.
I was at a conference in Germany about 7 or 8 years ago, and I was one of the few non-Europeans there. And the topic was the European Union and its future. And it was a pretty gloomy, not positive gathering. And it was many Europeans all talking about different parts of the EU that they thought needed work. And I didn't disagree with any of them. I think they were all very accurate in their vision of things that were wrong with the EU. But I couldn't stand it anymore, and I had to get up and say, look, you know, you're all right. These are all inevitable features of trying something new, something innovative. And I think the European Union is a very remarkable experiment in reorganizing governance. I can go on for days telling you what's wrong with the way they're doing it, not everything they're doing. So, I mean, I start from the principle that any organization, any government in the world does some things right and some things wrong. That, to me, it seems obvious. Possible exception is North Korea, who seems to do everything wrong, but that's the only one. And the European Union is the same. We speak now at a moment when the European Union has a real crisis on its hands. And I think you have, on the one hand, Greece and the Greek crisis, where Greece really, in some ways, was unprepared and unwilling to play the role it promised to play in a collective environment, and continued structures that were dysfunctional, that hadn't worked for 50 years, as mechanisms of governance and, more importantly, of finance, and that were also deeply corrupt. But on the other hand, you have the Germans, who tend to be very righteous about their success. So I think there's a real crisis on the top end of the European Union in that the Germans see themselves not accurately as carrying the weight of the world and of the European project. So here we go again, imbalance. They're finding their way. So I'm generally positive about the European project. I think it makes sense when you look at the countries that make up the EU. Many, many of them are very small, and they really have, particularly some of the newer members, they have infinitely more economic and social possibilities by being part of a confederation of some kind than by staying separate. So I think the idea is a solid one, but every good idea has its moments of crisis. You know, look at the lights again. Mr. Edison, there were moments when Mr. Edison said, this is not going to work. I've been trying to get this thing to light up, and it doesn't look like it's going to happen. That's part of an experiment. The European Union is a good experiment, but it's at a very tough moment right now.
Hello, my name is Krsmana Vitjeva. I'm a student from Serbia, and my question is about resource trade. You have mentioned that the future is exchanging goods that are in excess in certain countries. And you have mentioned the border between China and Russia. Mm-hmm. And the question I have is, will it lead to the era of exchanging goods? Not money for goods, but exchanging goods. And what will it cause in the money and the power balance in the world that is currently existing?
An even tougher question after a number of tough questions. Generally, I think yes, because remember Adam Smith, the wealth of nations. The wealth of nations lies in not just money, but also resources. Some of those resources are man-made, they're manufactured goods. Other resources are natural resources that are extracted from the earth. So that's where countries have relative advantages. And I think, indeed, the world is moving toward a point where they have to figure out in a very precise way how to exchange goods and services also. That's another thing, service industries. Almost every country, including Russia, wants to develop a better service sector because that's clearly where a lot of future economic value lies. Now, where it doesn't lie, boy, did we learn this, all of us, again, America started the problem in 2008-2009, is the creation of financial instruments that had no real value. These subprime mortgages, I didn't tell the whole subprime mortgage story, but the financial institutions that were just looking for new ways to make money. So if you only look to profit and not to society, you create these monsters. And these subprime mortgages, the way they worked was, okay, at the base, local real estate guys were selling houses to people who couldn't afford them. The mortgages were then bought up by banks and then other companies as well, who bundled them together into packages of a debt, and then sold them. And resold them. So you might have a mortgage on a house, but it was sold to five different institutions, and you'd get a letter saying, "Hello, we're the so-and-so corporation. We now own your mortgage. We bought it from this bank." So what you had, and then these went on the stock market. They became tradable commodities that were valued way above what they were worth, not the real This thing is worth a certain amount of money. You can know what this is worth. But these things, nobody knew what they were worth. So they created these fake financial structures that really had no value. And as the structures got bigger and bigger and bigger, like a house of cards, they got more fragile until the whole thing collapsed. So the global economy does not lie, one hopes, in the creation of these financial instruments that are not based on real things, real goods, real services, real people. And it's a big danger because banks and financial companies are very powerful today. You know, there are some people in America, and I might be one of them, who say that they have too much power and that they dictate how political leaders act and think. And maybe in other countries too, certainly in some European countries and other countries, they are so concerned with their profit line that they've lost sight of stakeholders and the value of real things by creating these financial instruments. So, it's very dangerous, clearly, because the way stock markets work. I mean, look what just happened to the Chinese stock market. It went up hugely and it fell down hugely. Now it's coming back a little bit. Fortunately for the Chinese, you have a system where the government can intervene very strongly and reverse things. Now, the story's not over. The Chinese stock market is not dead, but it's also not alive yet. We'll see what happens with that. But you you're right in your original assumption that I think that you said, which is that the world is going to move, I hope, to a more value-based system and less to these derivatives and fake creations of value, which by the way are a tremendous engine for creating income inequality. That's something I didn't mention, but boy, it's a problem in every country. It's very bad and very new in China. It's very bad in the United States. It's a problem here, not as much as in China and the US, is you have a society of people who are a tiny number of people who are very comfortable, indeed rich, and then much larger numbers of people who are poor. And in the United States, you have a colossal, I don't have the exact figures, but something like 80% of the GDP in America is owned by 2 or 3% of the people. Something wrong. There's something wrong in that picture.
Not only you answer my question, but not only in the country. Will it change the power distribution in the world? Will the other countries become more powerful when we switch from going to the money-based economy to the value-based economy?
Sure, I think so, because again, you know, most of the countries of the world, especially as you get to smaller countries, to less prosperous countries, will be able to have more say in their own future. If you have it dominated from a few centers of power, I mean, that's, you know, look, that's the way the world looked in 1600s, 1700s. You had UK, you had Netherlands, you had Portugal, you had Spain, they had colonies, they had these, the first multinational companies, the Dutch East India Company, the British East India Company, these trading companies that dominated the world economy, and the rest of the world was kind of left out of that process. So it's again, you could say the process of democratizing power in the world began in the 19th century with the nation state, despite its difficulties. And now you have certainly a more equal world than you did 500 years ago, but there's still a long way to go. And the introduction of financial capital and financial markets and a global economy creates some real opportunities for terrific, again, imbalance. Inequality is an imbalance. So there's, in physics, there's the principle of balance. In religion, in Buddhism, for instance, is again the principle of moderation and balance. And in many cultures and in many ways of thinking, balance is key. And I share that very much. I guess we're kind of over. And there's one lesson, the biggest public policy lesson of all is don't keep people from their lunch. So it's time to eat. Thank you so much. If you have any interest or questions in this, let us know. There's a number on the back.